Okay, so let's get going. So today we're going to continue the discussion of security that we started last time with Anthony. And so to review, there were four main concepts from last time. Authentication, quiet please. Authentication, which is guaranteeing the user is who they present to be. Integrity, which is ensuring that data reaches from a destination, reaches to a destination from a source, and or is written on a storage device without being changed somehow and corrupted. Confidentiality is that the data is only accessible to the users that it's intended for. And non-repudiation, which is that a commitment that's made by someone can't easily be undone without leaving some trace. And that's part of typically forming contracts, digital contracts between people. And it involves making somebody making a signature to something which they basically can't disown later. All right, so, and part of the core infrastructure for several of those operations is encryption and then digital signatures. So, you know, if we want to show that a particular key, a public key that anyone can examine, really belongs to a user called Alice, the idea is to take somebody else who's in trusted authority, who already has a published public key and is fully trusted and their infrastructure is trusted by lots of people, to sign the, such as VeriSign, to sign both Alice, her identity, her name, and then the key. So we construct a tuple of Alice and the key somehow. It can be simply by concatenating them. And then make a signature out of that by using encryption with VeriSign's private key. So this whole thing is basically, it's essentially like VeriSign signing a document that has Alice's name and then her published key on that document. All right, and then anyone else who wants to check can examine that. And they use the complementary public decryption method using VeriSign's public key, which is always going to invert messages, decrypt messages that are encrypted with their private key. And that's going to return the tuple that we originally encrypted, Alice and her key. So now Bob can tell that this key really is associated with Alice, at least according to VeriSign. VeriSign's committed that those two go together. And so if Bob trusts VeriSign, he can trust that this key, messages encrypted with this, the private key corresponding to that public key, really came from Alice. Okay? So one of many permutations of using signatures and digital signatures to make proofs of connections or commitment by different entities. So today we're going to look at the I suppose, offensive side of security, which is how various actors can try to attack, compromise, sometimes extract information, and sometimes simply cause damage to a target. So so attacks include, you know, basically compromising a host somehow, which means gaining control or at least resources from that host. Denial of service, which means somehow typically flooding a particular host with traffic and interfering with its normal operation. And attacks often involve both steps. So in order to perform a denial of service, you often need a very large volume of traffic. And an easy way to do that is to compromise a lot of hosts and form a network out of them and then target a small number or even a large number of other hosts to try to slow them down simply by the volume of traffic that you're creating. All right, so those are the main topics for today. So first of all, host compromise. So the earliest large-scale example of this was the Morris worm, or the internet worm, from 1988. That was created by Robert Tappan Morris, who was at the time a graduate student at Cornell. And it successfully broke into most of the BSD-based hosts, so it used code that was shared by most of them. and it spread very effectively across the internet. So luckily, that was only at the time about 6,000 machines. Now, given that there's many hundreds of millions of machines, it's estimated that a single worm could compromise about 10 million hosts in less than 5 minutes. So that's a massive scale. And at that scale, the economic damage is quite astronomical. So Robert Tappan Morris was convicted and got a $10,000 fine and 400 hours of community service and a job at MIT eventually, although not as part of the same packet. But it was a very sort of a slap in the wrist. People really had no parameters for that kind of offense. But these days, this kind of damage is absolutely massive. So obviously, there's a lot of effort that goes into both preparing these attacks and also preventing them. All right, so attacker wants to gain control of a host, sometimes to just get information. So some part of this is professional, and it's for corporate espionage, and sometimes government espionage. In some cases, it's a denial of service attack, which is often perpetrated by sort of casual hackers, sometimes by security agencies. So the Stuxnet worm or virus was launched deliberately to interfere with machines in the Iranian nuclear program. It was sort of a concerted attack at fairly large scale to affect those devices. And in some cases, again, if you have malicious intents, you can, rather than capturing data, you can erase data to cause interference with the operation of something. So, all right, so a variety of bad things can be done. So a worm is something that replicates itself somehow. First of all, it has to get into a host. Then it has to find a way to execute some code and then reproduce itself. Most often that's done exploiting careless programming, and especially text string buffers in C, which aren't protected in length and allow the programmer to, allow the code to write over legitimate data on the stack and interfere with other data. So a virus is a piece of code that's attached instead to a legitimate document or email message and is opened off sometimes inadvertently by a user who believes they're doing a legitimate operation or accessing some legitimate object by clicking on a link. And so a virus does a similar thing. The clicking operation executes the code and allows the virus to run and do more or less arbitrary things to the host. And finally, a Trojan horse is a sort of a malicious piece of sleeping code that somehow gets executed on the host. It can come through a virus or through some kind of compromised port or insecure port. It lodges on the host and then provides basically a remote socket through which the attacker can launch other kinds of attack. So it essentially opens a back door in the computer for a subsequent execution of code. All right, and when hosts are collected together, and especially like hosts that can run Trojan horse programs, a collection of those together is called a botnet, and the hosts themselves are called zombies. And those can be used to spread worms, and also to mount distributed denial of service attacks. All right, so Trojan horses are very effective, viruses are very effective, because they often use fairly simple everyday operations that users do, and they masquerade as benign pieces of email, and it's very easy for users to mistake what the message is and click on some link and get into trouble. And the infection can be, it'll be obvious or it can be benign as well. Sometimes you see immediately the computer's behaving strangely, but it can also be a sleeper virus that's going to run a keystroke logger and collect your information and passwords, or may simply open up a port on your machine and allow the machine to be used in a botnet. So, you know, two bad things. You know, you can see this one. It's masquerading as a greeting coming from a friend. Sometimes there'll be a name in there that looks, you know, a common name, makes it very easy to assume that this is a benign thing. And the link itself, you know, it's easy enough in the text of an HTML link to put a legitimate link that's different from the actual link in the underlying HTML. So rarely are you clicking on what you appear to be clicking. So it's difficult to spot these, but and unsophisticated users are especially prone to doing this. But the easiest thing is to assume if it could be a virus, and obviously this can be because you can't see what the real link is. You know, when you mouse over this, you'll typically see the actual link, which is safer. But if it could be a virus, the safe thing is not to click on it. All right. So let's look a bit more closely at how these buffer overflows happen. All right, so the idea is that the hacker somehow figures out that there's some buffer in a program that's accessible remotely or email. They figure out that there's a buffer there that's got a fixed size programmed into the C code, usually, that they can override if they use a larger message. So especially this is true of cookies, which normally do have a fixed length. But if the code's not carefully written, it will allow the string of the cookie to be written, even if it's arbitrary length. So here's a get cookie routine, a sort of a straw man get cookie routine, receives the string of a packet, and it does calls a subroutine to process the packet, which doesn't do much except eventually locates the cookie part of the packet here. So this code here is parsing the packet contents, looking for some header that says cookie. It retrieves the location of the cookie, puts it in N. So then this address here should be the address of a string, which is the beginning of the cookie. And so in normal execution, it should be safe to copy that string into the cookie routine, which is just a fixed length buffer here on the stack. Okay? So the normal execution on most machines, so most machines have a stack that grows down. The MIPS machines that you program and also Intel machines normally grow their stack downwards. So one of those machines, the main automatic variables will sit in an area of memory like this on the stack. It's going to progress down. When you do a function call here, it will push the return address on the stack as well. So that's going to come down just below the local variables on the frame. And that return address is going to point back to the point just after the function call. All right? So stack's going downwards. And then the stack frame of the function being called is going to be added below that on the stack. And that contains this variable n, which is just the address in the packet of the cookie, and the cookie itself, which should be bounded by 512 bytes. So somewhere in this processing routine, so first of all, you figure out actually what n is. So it saves the location of where the cookie should be in n. And then it calls this notoriously dangerous C routine string copy. And string copy, you know, as you probably most of you know, for C strings, takes the sequence of bytes until it finds a zero as the end of string marker. And it copies all of that into cookie. All right, so if it's actually bounded by 512 bytes, it should copy those up into, where are we, into here. And we add the string return address just as before, and then there's a stack frame associated with the string copy itself, which has just a couple of variables in it. So, all right, so for a legitimate cookie, we'll execute this code down to here, and the string copy is just going to move the contents of the packet, probably from the heap somewhere, into its local cookie variable, which is some space in the stack. So here it's somewhat less than 512 bytes long, and it's effectively growing up. This is going to be, you know, it's an array, so its addresses are going to be increasing, which means the first address is going to be the lowest address numerically. So it's going to be going up from that address on the stack. So the rest of the functions will execute. They'll return whatever Munch was going to do. It'll finish off. It'll return back to get cookie using that address, which actually I'll put it back there. So each return address, after you finish executing a function, you drop back to the return address. So here we are. We just finished executing this routine Munch, so we will grab the address that was pushed on the stack in order to return from it. And finally, you know, you're back to the original get cookie. So everything went according to the programmer's plan. But let's look at the buffer overflow case. So now the difference is again, we're going to do the string copy, but this time, if the data being copied, you know, if the string that's inside this packet is longer than 512 bytes, it's going to write all the way up here. And if the hacker who did this knows either by knowledge of the code that they're trying to hack or by trial and error, knows that the return address here is just above, well, in this case, it's just slightly above the length of the cookie. So it's 512 bytes plus 4 bytes because there's the length there. But by trial and error, the hacker can put the address of some other code, which could itself live on the stack. And the routine, when it comes back, when it tries to return from this routine here, will have this bogus address that it will try to follow to get back. So in that way, the hacker can actually get both insert code and then create a link to it in that step. Yeah? Well, you can do that. That's one of the techniques for preventing this. So yes, that's one of the techniques for trying to prevent that particular version where the code's on the stack. So yes, but it's only one of, it's not always a reliable operation. And in the case of HTML, there's often executable JavaScript or Java code that's part of the HTTP message somewhere else. So it may be that it tries, yeah, I guess in that case, it tries to link to that code as though it were a legitimate executable as part of the executable part of the HTML code. All right, so yeah, but anyway, all of those steps will help. So in this case, yeah, we're just showing the simplest case where it actually is executable code right on the stack. But there's other ways of doing it. All right, so and you can see by the time we get back, when the time we return from the second routine, what we're actually doing is executing that little link into executable code that we wrote. So yeah, there's lots of variations on that, and you know, links can be to binary code or Java code, depending on the environment that this is being interpreted in. All right, so one question is, if you notice, we got into trouble by growing the stack. Part of the trouble was the stack grew downwards, which means the buffer, when it's being written, goes upwards. Would it fix things if we went downwards? I'm sorry, excuse me. Will we fix things if we grew the stack upwards? So in other words, the stack would be growing up instead of down, so that then the buffers would be written mostly into empty space. Would that work? Not necessarily. Very good answer. Yes. So, well, that's one situation, is that there could be other programs in the space, but it becomes a lot less likely to be successful if there's if you don't know the offsets. But there's another reason that this still doesn't work. In fact, it doesn't even work in the example. Because it probably works more often, though. It probably makes it harder for the attacker to succeed. But the trouble is here, if you notice, there was another return address that was inserted right after the string copy. And the string copy was the function that's actually doing the dangerous write. So the trouble is, if we did reverse the stack, so now the stack is going up instead of down. So everything sort of flipped upside down. The return address after the string copy is on the top now. But in this case, the write's going to go up as well. But although it didn't clobber this address, it clobbered that return address. So this would be safe if we hadn't called a function there. Right, if the code itself had done the copy with a for loop or something, it should have been all right, because that basically we'd be writing, we might have overwritten some data, but we wouldn't have overwritten a return address. So probably if people had, for whatever reason, if designers had designed the stacks to go the other way, things would be a little bit harder for hackers. You'd need this combination of code patterns to be in place in order for it to work. Whereas the downward facing stack, it's potentially always dangerous because there's always going to be stack frames sitting above the current frame. So if there is a buffer overrun problem, it's almost always going to be exploitable. All right, so let's keep going. All right, so when a host is compromised, the attacker gets to do whatever they want. Usually that involves finding more hosts to compromise than having the virus copy itself. So, and that often involves picking random IP addresses, random, which can be encoded as 32-bit words. There's some interesting, well, we'll get to this later when we discuss particular viruses and worms, but this fortunately has actually not been very well executed in some large-scale worms. So anyway, so the idea of the worm then is, because it's randomly generating new hosts to attack, it's going to spread normally exponentially at the beginning, because each sort of generation of the worm is going to attack some large number of other hosts, let's say k, and so each time, each generation is multiplying its size by roughly k. So that can cause extremely fast infection across the network. Really a really nice, simple, parallel algorithm. In fact, it's breadth-first search. Okay. And empirically, this is the kind of growth that you see. If you ignore this term for a minute, at least initially, the growth is exponential. You can see it here. So it's e to some kt. And gradually over time, so that causes this fast, explosive growth. And then another phenomenon kicks in, which is the network starts to saturate and the virus or worm can't find new hosts to infect. And, well, okay, so we'll get to the, we'll repeat this in a second, because this was misunderstood also famously by one of the virus authors. All right, so you can see the exponential growth initially, once you start to have a significant fraction of the internet infected, then it slows down quite a lot. So some famous examples of worms. The first famous and successful worm was the internet worm, or the Morris worm from 1988. And as we saw, it was relatively small scale, simply because the network was fairly small scale, and it's thought to infect it about 6,000 hosts. Code Red was a newer generation of worm, a fairly efficiently coded one from 2001. That was able to infect nearly 500,000 hosts in about 10 hours. But then, you know, as the viruses became more sophisticated, in particular, they switched from using TCP connections in this virus to using UDP, because if you recall TCP, when it establishes a connection, it does a SYN request, waits for an acknowledgement. So there's a round trip involved in causing a new host to be infected. Slammer instead used UDP, which is a connectionless protocol. So it just was able to send out packets in parallel, not waiting for a response. And it was able to cause damage much faster using a UDP address in Microsoft SQL Server. And this is sort of the state of the art, and current viruses are thought to go much faster. So zero-day exploit. Zero-day refers to the number of days between the recognition of a vulnerability by the software company and the time at which it's exploited by a virus writer or a worm author. Zero-day is the worst case, which means that it's an unknown exploit. So in other words, the hackers discover the buffer overrun problem before Microsoft does or before the Linux authors do. And so that virus, you know, there'll be a lag before that virus can be recognized and before a patch can be distributed, during which it's going to spread as fast as the theoretical limits allow. And the theoretical limits now are of the order of 1 million hosts in about 1.3 seconds. And the estimated damage of that kind of worm is in the tens of billions of dollars. And yeah, we're probably lucky that we haven't had worse infections. So a lot of the viruses that we'll see in a second, we'll just talk a little bit more about them, have had some fairly serious flaws in their design. So they were not as bad as they could have been. So Robert Morris's worm, back in the 80s when this was written, most of the internet was Unix hosts, and a lot of them used the BSD, parts of the BSD distribution. And Morris's claim that he was trying to measure the size of the internet with breadth-first search, but there were a couple of things wrong with his claim. One of them is that he carefully disguised the source of the infection. So he was working at Cornell as a graduate student, but he actually launched it from MIT, which oddly enough eventually became his employer. But the other thing is that he used a number of security exploits to do this, rather than simply asking people if he could run code on their machines. And he didn't tell anyone he was doing it either. And the exploits he used were, you know, actually very common exploits which have been used over and over again. He did actually also rely on the academic networks. Again, academic networks were a big part of the internet at the time. And people often created chains of automatic login from one machine to another and enabled the remote shell access, which is an insecure version of SSH access, remote access. So so he did marshal a lot of sort of loopholes that were present in the network at the time in order to get this to work. Yeah, and it was, well, he claimed it was benign. Obviously, the courts didn't believe that. But it did have a bug, which was that he was afraid that system administrators would try to kill this bug by recognizing that there was an instance of it running, and or masquerading for a running instance. So he thought that if they sort of masquerade that there's already an infection and my infection stops when it sees that it's already running, that's bad. So what he did instead was randomly try to reinfect with some probability, and it was 1 in 7. So when the virus encountered a host that had no sign of already being installed, it would run immediately. Otherwise, it would die with 6 chances out of 7, but on the 7th chance, it would run again. And that was critical. So he mistakenly thought that by running fewer instances of the virus, it would slow it down enough to not cause an exponential explosion. But the trouble is that because there was no bound on the outer degree of the virus, all he actually did was slow things down. Actually, I think I have the curve coming up. Oh, no, I don't have to go back, sorry. So, yeah, this curve here So by simply reducing the probability of infection for this type of worm, which is just going to continue attacking hosts, what he actually did was just reduce the constant K. But the shape of this curve isn't actually affected by the constant K. It's only the scale. So if I modify K, all I'm doing effectively is scaling time here. And so this curve sort of elongates, but it has the same asymptotic effect. So that mistake, that was a bad mistake, which made it, which made it actually a lot more dangerous than it could have been. Instead of being a benign breadth-first search that would have basically ran on each machine once, it became this exponentially growing worm, which also caused systems to lock up once they overloaded the number of connections they could support. Okay. All right. So code red. So code red is a really, it's a cool sounding name for a virus, but the name actually came from the people that discovered the virus who are apparently looking at cans of code red Mountain Dew while they were doing this work late at night. So it sounds like some formal name from a spy agency, a national security agency, but it's just a soda drink name. So code red, in 2001, people have started to install firewalls. Things are a bit more safe. But nevertheless, this virus successfully targeted port 80, which is much more accessible and much more freely admitted through firewalls. So this was a smart choice. And there's unfortunately a buffer overflow exploit in the HTTP server code. And the worm was able to copy itself using that exploit, similar to what we described earlier, and then execute a random scan and infect more hosts. So unfortunately, the first version of the bug didn't work very well. And it turned out the random number generation that was hand-coded had some problems in it, which caused, in this case, the random number generator used a fixed seed, which meant that the same, whenever the worm ran, it would execute and try to infect the same host in the same order. So you can see you really defeat the value of parallelism in that case, and it was a lot slower than it could have been. But anyway, the authors did fix it, so the second generation of Code Red used a time or some other varying information from the host, and it was able to go a lot faster. All right, so in that one, the authors weren't conclusively identified, but they're believed to have come from the Philippines. All right, so Slammer, just a few years later, was a very scary virus. So, I'm out of sequence here. All right, sorry. So SQL Slammer exploited a vulnerability in Microsoft SQL Server. And this was a very fast-moving virus because this particular vulnerability was based on a service that ran over UDP. So it didn't require connections to be established before the offending code could be sent across the network. So that made it vastly faster to deploy and infect. And you had this this massive number of hosts hit in a matter of minutes and seconds. The good thing about this particular malicious code was that it didn't affect all machines on the internet. Because it was using a SQL Server vulnerability, it only affected server machines. And a handful of machines, of user machines that had a SQL service, sometimes it's attached to Microsoft's developer suite as well. So some developer machines again, but mostly servers. So luckily there was a limited number of those, but they did include name servers for the internet. And a large fraction of those went down as a result of this. In a sense, there was another design weakness in this virus, which is it spread very fast, but just like natural viruses, it also killed off the hosts fairly fast. So once a host was hit, it would become overloaded and typically shut down. And that's, you know, with natural viruses too, nature has figured out that very fast spreading viruses are often, they're typically not optimal. The best virus is one that is slow enough to impair the host, spread a lot, but continue to allow the host to keep running. And the more sophisticated viruses these days follow that pattern. So they will establish a certain number of connections and then stop so that the, or maintain that number of connections. So that the infecting host basically corrupts a number of target machines and then doesn't kill it, doesn't stop itself, but continues to complete the operations on those connections that it already has. And it can corrupt more hosts that way. And so what's shown in this plot is the actual observed impact of this virus. Even though it was affecting servers and some name servers, it caused significant packet loss both directly and indirectly, some through network traffic and some through the fact that these network servers were going offline. But it actually was quenched fairly quickly on when it first established itself on Saturday. But then 2 days later, there's this huge spike, which happened because people turned their server machines on a Monday morning, first in, I guess, Europe and then in the US. And so, you know, these hosts, that some have been taken offline, some of them simply crashed, and there was an equilibrium reached fairly quickly. But then the infection sort of reinitialized almost to the same degree when people brought all of the other machines online that had been idle over the weekend. All right, and this is, you can read about this on the F-Secure site. That's a security monitoring company in Finland. All right, so, okay. Yeah, so we're a little bit out of sequence here, sorry. But so Slammer uses this UDP point, UDP UDP port as an exploit. So there's a listening process on that particular port that has a buffer overrun problem. And allows code to execute and forward on these requests to other sites randomly. And it was able to bring down a large number of root name servers, which also use SQL Server. A very interesting design choice here, I guess if you're a virus writer, is that it only used in-memory access. It didn't write itself out to disk. And it seems like that was a good, clever design decision in terms of it making it very hard for people to figure out who wrote this. And people never did. There were no timestamps about, and they couldn't even figure out, as we'll see in a second, which machine was hit first. It did make dealing with the bug fairly easy. At least once you closed that port on a firewall, you could simply restart the machine because it was there was no persistent state. It was only code running live for some time. So you could reboot and that the problem would go away. So interestingly enough, the first infected host was never found. So that's 10 years later. And the author was never discovered either. People really don't have much idea. Even the programmers who originally discovered this virus wrote about it extensively, but no one ever figured out who was the cause. Some things they could figure out, though, from the code itself were that whoever did this wasn't a very effective programmer. So this one also had more subtle bugs in its random number generation. In this case, they basically copied a random number generator from somewhere else, but flipped an XOR for an OR and forgot to add one to the 2's complement negation of a number. So it was apparently encoded in assembly language with some bugs. And fortunately, that actually meant that there was a big chunk of address space that it didn't target because the random number simply didn't generate a fraction of the IP addresses. So you can see a pattern that has been consistent in a lot of these big viruses, that they could have been a lot worse. But fortunately, the people that have really have the most skill at writing this kind of software seem to be not the same people that are writing it so far. And there are some exceptions recently because this is becoming both a corporate process and also a government process. All right, so to just summarize some of the techniques that people have used, yeah, question. I mean, there's certainly, Macs seem to have been doing better, but they certainly are amenable to similar viruses to Windows.
Is there a reason that people think that? I mean, are they less targeted for some reason, or is there?
There's fewer. So, you know, hackers that want to include the team for a project want to include a lot of people. I'm not going to hold on to Windows. I can expect 400 million people. How many tens of millions of Macs are there out there? But there are now more Macs out there, so the Flash Macs version.
Yeah, I mean, I you know, there are viruses targeted at iPads and Android devices as well. It's just been, those have been smaller markets, but they're starting to grow a lot because those devices are, you know, just, they're much more common, they're much more online. And so, yeah, we'll probably see a lot more generalized viruses than traditional Windows viruses. Yeah. Well, the earliest ones seemed to be more exploratory. Now it's more, there's more of an industry what's the word? I mean, I guess it's a government industry. A lot of governments sort of run formal programs to disrupt the operations, extract information from other agencies, other countries. And you know, yeah. Yeah, that's very true. Yeah, so that's true. I mean, cybercrime is much more, you know, this large scale sale of passwords. I think Vern Paxson was telling us you can buy Facebook. Also, people actually, you know, acquire Facebook IDs so they can use them as credentials to obtain other kinds of credential. So there's a market in identities as well that's growing a lot. So the types of exploit are diversifying and growing. The exploits have traditionally come from a few sources, though. A variety of Unix tools, which are the ones that Robert Morris used originally. A number of vulnerabilities have shown up in IIS, Windows Web Server, and the mail protocol, which is used by various devices to manage the network. It's also been a source of many problems. All right, so let's discuss some of the solutions, and there was a suggestion for one of them that is actually used. The first one is not to write buggy software. What is perhaps surprising about these kind of vulnerabilities is that they have occurred in code that was written after people were aware of these problems, and somehow really shouldn't have happened. Some of the older code that was grandfathered in from Berkeley Unix, you can perhaps understand, but some of the other large vendors whose name I've said many times but I won't say again, you know, should have known better, and there should have been more discipline to prevent that kind of problem recurring. So, you know, obviously string copy is a frequent offender. There's a string ncopy, which is a standard library routine which simply limits the number of bytes that you can write, which is much better. You can try to run code checking, which will spot some of these most likely offenders. People don't seem to like to do that, although it's surprising, you know, some of the exploits aren't as obvious as that either. so it's harder to track them by automated means. There are many languages that lack most of these vulnerabilities, like Java, Perl, Python, etc. The problem is that then there are other kinds of vulnerabilities sort of below the hood in the virtual machine itself that you can try to exploit instead. But anyway, direct access to blocks of memory, as in C, is a bad idea. C++, even going to C++ with encapsulated strings is a lot better because the strings have length and so on that's encapsulated in the string object, which normally prevent you from doing bad things by overrunning. Hardware support and control of what regions of memory can be executed is a very good idea. And so we discussed that the tools for that earlier on in the course. This is what segmentation was for, right? The step before pageable memory, we discussed the notion of abstract blocks of memory that only had certain types of access permitted. And so, yes, making stack and heap non-executable is a good idea. Well, stack, yes, maybe heap is tricky, though, because you may have chunks of code that you want to execute in there. But anyway, that is one of the techniques that you can use. people have explored more exotic techniques, like address-based randomization, which, you know, basically tries to cause the memory to be mapped in a random pattern so that when things overrun, the bytes are scattered across memory and unlikely to be reproducibly hitting an address. But apart from the technical challenges of getting that to work, there's serious performance penalties when you're trying to access memory sequentially and it's been randomized in that way. And finally, you can try to prevent access of processes to other processes, data and address space. It should in principle confine the effects of one of these pieces of malicious code away from other things that are running. Yeah. Well, I looked this stuff up just briefly, so I don't know, Anthony might know more about this, but no, it seems to be, as I understood it, to be a physical address thing, so that basically writing to an erroneous address goes to a random location in physical memory and doesn't hit, has a low probability of hitting something that contains an address, a return value or something that's going to be executed. I think just aside from the circumvention, though, it does cause this sort of really nasty fragmentation of memory, though, so that when you're trying to, stream through memory, it's really defeating you. All right, so, and firewalls are obviously an important part of the solution as well, and we'll talk about these in the second half of the lecture. All right, so we're drawing to the end of the semester. Midterm's coming up, the second midterm next week on Wednesday. And we have two rooms, again, and so we're splitting up alphabetically. And the review session, we don't have a room yet, as far as I know, but it's going to probably be on Sunday evening. That seemed to be the best time, best compromise time that we could find. It'll be a similar format with a a cheat sheet, two-sided cheat sheet of notes, and it's going to cover everything since the last midterm, so lectures, projects, and readings. Okay, so any questions? All right. And of course, there's no final. Project 4 is coming up. I know people are going to be probably doing other things this weekend, so please plan to get your design doc though in on Monday by midnight. All right, so that's the last one. And Project 4 itself will stretch out for a few more weeks after that. Okay. All right, so break, and we'll just wrap up and discuss firewalls in the end. Okay. So let's finish up. All right, so let's review some of the things that we talked about today. All right, so a digital certificate provides a binding between a host's identity and their public key. True or false? Okay, one true. Anyone else? Yeah, okay, that's right. Oops, there we go. Okay, a server must store a user's password in plain text so it can be checked against the submitted password. All right, okay. Worms require human intervention to propagate. Right, some viruses do, all right. And what about type-safe languages eliminates the risk of buffer overflows? Well, we kind of implied it was true. I mean, they don't completely eliminate it, but they significantly reduce the frequency of the simple ones that we described by basically, preventing overrun of write of arrays. You can't access beyond an array in Java, beyond the end of an array. Okay. A key concept of security these days is a firewall, which is some machine that's either inserted on the boundary of a network, typically in a protected domain like a campus or a business, and it stands between the machines inside the boundary and the rest of the internet. And in some cases, it may actually reside as software on a machine. So Microsoft has this firewall that you adjust locally on your machine to prevent certain types of access. And the idea of the firewall is to restrict the type of access that can come through the network into the domain. And the restrictions can be done in a variety of ways. They can be based on the originating address, source address, and port number, based on the type of payload in the packets, which is a stateless test. It may say simply, I won't accept TCP packets or UDP packets or FTP packets. Or it can be based on a stateful analysis, which is what you need if you want to allow outbound connections but prevent inbound connections. You may want your hosts inside of the firewall to be able to establish connections and then receive data from the hosts that they are trying to access. And that requires some stateful analysis for the firewall to understand that packet is part of a connection that's being established from inside. So some of the rules that the firewall will execute could be, for instance, which is very commonly done, is just blocking things that are not for HTTP, because almost everybody wants to have a web presence, so they have to admit HTTP requests through their firewall, inbound ones, but they may screen out everything else. That's probably the most common setup. They may prevent emails that have attachments, because those have the risk of containing viruses, and they may block external packets that have an internal address. So in other words, they may just prevent direct access to an interior host. All right, so so obviously with a firewall, it gives you the opportunity to secure a whole bunch of machines which may not themselves be very well maintained or secure. It doesn't prevent the attachment of malicious software to email messages that people then open. So, it's still going to admit email traffic, which will allow potentially people to get in trouble. And also, I guess, social media, which rely on primarily HTTP as a protocol, are also going to be kind of backdoors that will still be able to bypass the firewall. All right, and with the firewall, you're trying to balance the accessibility of the services that you do want to support against the protection of everything else. So, and a second thing is if the firewall is too restrictive, legitimate users sometimes will find ways of getting around the security in order to do the things they want to do, and that can cause a lot of trouble. So they may, for instance, set up tunnels through port 80 using VPN or something else. Which is generally secure, but if they have kind of insecure if they do SSH connections without keys between a bunch of machines, it means that an attacker that compromises that one user's machine can in effect get inside their business network and then gather data or do other malicious things. So you have to be careful that users, you know, there's a very strong human force, which is people want to get work done. And so if the firewall makes that too difficult, then the users themselves, the legitimate ones, are going to be the ones actually digging under the firewall to get through it. All right. Anyway, so we saw that port 80 is most commonly left open so that you can have IP services. And that implies that other services, often legitimately, will try to use port 80 to get in and use instead a tunneling process, which means basically transforming the port number to port 80, transposing it, and then running a pattern-based filter on the other side, which will then distribute the traffic based on stateful information or based on the type of packet. So in other words, you sort of demultiplex all of the things going through port 80 to different services. Right, so one of the most common problems now, one of the most common threats is denial of service, which means usually traffic or cycles that are run on a machine in order to interfere with the operation of that machine or other machines. So let's see, in 2001 there was a series of attacks, denial of service attacks on many of the large internet portals, and they managed some 12,000 different hosts being targeted in about 2,000 different domains, 2,000 different companies in just 1 week. Those came from compromised hosts, but the compromised hosts were large enough in number to significantly interfere with the operations of these large entities. And an interesting attack was this one. So Spam House is a filter provider. Basically, this is an agency that in international agency in, I think it's Britain and Geneva and Switzerland, and they provide a service to other companies, which basically is a blacklist of bad sites that they believe to be bad or they prove to be bad. Cyberbunker is a hosting company that started in Holland, and now whose location is unknown. And they provide hosting of almost any service on the web, and except for child pornography and declared terrorists, but they will host anything else. So they will host sort of pirated things like Pirate Bay. WikiLeaks, a lot of the WikiLeaks data was hosted by them. And allegedly also a lot of malicious code, hacker groups that exchange information about viruses and host malicious software were also hosted by them. So, you know, reputedly these are bad guys. They seem to actually really be bad guys. They've gone underground, so that's a pretty good sign. Spam House was filtering their content and saying anything from there is bad. And these guys didn't like that very much, so they successfully, given that they have a whole community of hackers and malicious code, fairly successfully launched a denial of service attack against the filtering company. So spring this year, they launched an attack with more than 500,000 packets a second at this agency here, and you know, really effectively shut them down. and the perpetrator seems to be just one person who was actually identified and arrested in April, and had a little moving van with antennas, I guess mobile satellite internet, or I'm not really sure, maybe a variety of different wireless channels from his van. So it tells you a few things. You know, the attacks can be very very powerful, maybe only takes one person to do them, but they're also really good resources of code, compromised machine IP addresses, all kinds of things. Basically, botnets are often for sale, not sometimes, often for sale. So you can also buy a botnet fairly easily and, you know, use it to launch various other attacks. So, all right, yeah. anyway, so the general form of a denial of service attack is somehow preventing legitimate users from gaining a service either on one machine, overloading it from within, or overloading it from outside. So one of the common attacks is a SYN attack, and through TCP. And well, buggy implementations. I mean, even normal implementations of TCP will be susceptible to this, and we'll see in a second how they operate. But basically, the attacker launches a lot of connect requests from different hosts, none of which are actually going to complete. It just makes the request. And the host starts executing the protocol to accept the connection and then just sits and waits. But it's committed some resources to each of those requests, and that will eventually cause it to crash. so since this happens, this shouldn't really happen, but more recent implementations of TCP will limit the number of connections that it will actually accept and attempt to open so that it doesn't run out of resources. And then the new ones will just be dropped. So, but if you don't do this defensive coding, then because the sort of set of resources that can accept connect request is saturated, you can't make any more connections. So all of the legitimate connections that are coming into this host will be denied. And in fact, the machine may also crash because it won't be able to allocate memory for other things. So just to quickly review how TCP connections get established, you have some client that's initiating the connection and then a server that's going to receive it. And if you recall, there are two sets of sequence numbers. The client has a set of sequence numbers that they start with that allows them to keep track of their traffic. The SYN and ACK request creates this new sequence number, which is belongs to the server, and that's how, you know, they keep things in their sequence. And so the client is supposed to send an acknowledgement of the acknowledgement, which has the sequence number, the next sequence number after the server's number. All right? So that's what's normally supposed to happen. But if this, in a denial of service attack, a client can just send a SYN packet, wait for or ignore the response, and then never send this ACK, or send it, doesn't matter too much. In either case, the server has to wait in a state where it's, for instance, got to remember Y so that it can check the Y plus one that comes back, make sure it's a legitimate acknowledgement of its acknowledgement. And it's normally implemented as a state machine, so it's normally going to remember what state it's in based on having done this first round of messages. And, you know, you might continue on here, but you would still be in a particular state of the state machine, and you still want to remember your sequence numbers. So, so the simple version of the attack is to just send lots of these SYN messages. Each one of them creates a bit of state on the host, and those accumulate, and eventually the host runs out of memory. Let's see, so the attacker, yes, and you know, a common thing that you want to overcome is if you get lots of connect requests from the same client, a server might easily ignore that. So usually the attacker is going to spoof its own address, which you just, all you have to do is insert the source address, a different source address from the real one, in the packets themselves. The IP packets have the source host address in them. So you insert a false address there, and the receiving server will, you know, assume these are coming from different hosts. It has no way to check. So it'll have to respond to all of them. Some of them may be legitimate. And from the host's point of view, the server's point of view, it looks like they're receiving these requests from different clients. And yeah, go ahead.
How about the backup? So if you have the server,
Oh, that's an interesting question. But let's see. But the MAC address is not, the MAC address is not going to be in the, MAC address is going to be local to the a physical network, though. So when it's sending, so what you'll actually see would normally be the MAC address of the router that sent you, you know, the entity that's on the network that you're on, right? Because remember, the MAC address is an address on a particular physical network of the packet that is being formed. So, and since, you know, the originating network is some physical, let's say some physical Ethernet, the destination address may be a different type of network. So normally the physical addresses are, well, they should just be local, so it wouldn't have that information. All right, so one solution of this, it's borrows from cookies in web browsers, is to offload the state of the connection onto the client and make, in effect, a stateless connection. So the server proceeds as normal. When it receives the SYN request, connection request, it will send back an acknowledgement packet, but it will use a sequence number Y, which is a hash of client IP address, client port, and server key. And let's see, the client has all of this information. And let me see, yeah, actually it wouldn't matter. All right, and then forgets about the connection attempt. So the client responds normally, sending this acknowledgement. And then the server is going to verify. I should have said the server is going to forget about the connection attempt at the first step. So unlike the previous picture where the server's remembering why, at this state in this protocol, it's a stateless version of the previous protocol where the server forgets about this connection. So it doesn't have to save any state. It does send the acknowledgement. And then it waits to receive the second round packet from the client, which should be address Y plus one. The server can then, at that stage, check whether it's in sequence, because it can regenerate Y using this information. Yeah. Yeah, it's something like this. So it's like the idea of cookies normally, which are offloading from the server's database to a client file system, so that it does a number of things. It makes it a lot quicker usually to access the data. It saves a lot of storage on the host, and it makes the connections, makes the whole protocol simpler by making them stateless. So is that clear? So there's some limitations on this, especially the way this is presented, because you can see the this Y is really only allowing one connection from that client at a time anyway. But anyway, with that limitation, yeah, go ahead. All right, that was a lot of changes to this, and I'm trying to understand what can you explain what you were trying to do with that?
So I get the SYN act, and save that.
The client saves it, right?
Yeah, client saves it.
Well, the client's, you know, yeah, okay. And then what happens?
And then it saves a bunch of you, and then it sends them to the server all at once.
All right, so you're suggesting like an attack where the client does a lot of these, is that right? So, all right, well, yeah, you're trying to create a denial of service attack downstream, right? I think this is like the sketch of the first step of this protocol. You want to do something stateless at each step of the protocol. So, yes, the idea, well, so, I mean, remember that this, this protocol here is still responding to all of the SYN requests that it receives. It's just not saving state. So, but generally that's going to allow it to deal with a lot more connections. I mean, this operation is pretty fast. So, in fact, this sort of thing is generally fast enough. It could, you know, basically receive these requests more or less at the saturation value of the network. It would be of that order. So in a sense, it can't really get overloaded. And as long as you continue to do stateless steps, which you presumably will want to do at every step of this process, you should be fine. So I don't know if that makes sense. But so I think you're worried about the same problem happening downstream. Yeah, I mean, it can. You want to use the same idea at every step of the protocol. So basically store the state remove the need to store state information on the server. So I don't know how you do that, but the idea should work, which is sort of push the state into the client. Perhaps, you know, adding extra state information in the hash, because it's perhaps putting, well, yeah, as soon as you put the server's key in here, you should be able to verify. So anyway, all right. So you can also often improve access, like if you have an attacker that's been identified or flagged as such and screened out by a firewall. A common way around that is to use reflection, which means instead of directly attacking, the attacker can send to a compromised machine here, which will launch its own packet to the victim. The source address, sorry, this is the source address here, will be the reflector address, and the victim will be the target. Okay, so let's look at some ways of stopping attacks. Actually, I'm running a little bit. How much am I behind? Where am I? Yeah, all right. Let's try to go quickly through this. So egress filtering is stopping outbound packets which don't have a valid source address. So that's, in other words, preventing people inside of a domain from spoofing their addresses. And if that were done everywhere, it would actually prevent spoofing. you can include traceback information in packets to allow routers to trace malicious packets. All right, so distributed denial of service is the big problem these days. That was used in the cyber bunker attack. All right, so the idea is you marshal a huge number of machines. Some of them, I think, probably were bought. Some of them maybe have been directly compromised. Last thing I'll talk about is two-factor authentication, which is, you know, becoming increasingly important. It's usually used in most organizations, most companies now, some form of this. Typically involves two out of three things. So something the user knows, usually password, and people are exploring with visual authentication, like recognizing friend's face. Something that user has, which can be a secure fob or dongle, ATM cards for authentication with a bank, and a lot of experiments now with various vital signs authentication, including faces being commercially used, voice, not for very secure things, but face recognition is available commercially, voice recognition, voice user recognition, fingerprints are the traditional ones, and even heart rate. The heart rate waveform is a fairly good identifier. So two-factor authentication involves two of these factors, typically password and a authenticating card, but in the future we'd like to use more biosigns authentication because people are good at losing those things. There was an interesting attack on RSA, who make one of the most widely used security fobs, and basically hackers successfully, through some people that they knew inside the company, successfully infiltrated the machines and were able to grab a large number of passwords. They basically had the private keys and the data with which to really simulate these devices for a large number of fobs and effectively penetrate many, many companies. So that was pretty serious. So in spite of the fact that these devices they provide a very high level of security when correctly used, and when the private key data is fully protected, they're interestingly amenable to the same kind of human frailty that all systems are amenable to. So in fact, that system's been very successfully hacked at scale. But nevertheless, people still use this. This still seems to be the preferred validation technology by many companies. All right, so there's the attack. All right, and I won't talk about advanced persistent threats. This is just the basically corporate espionage technique, which involves long-term placement of malicious code and gradually escalating access of security and capabilities so that you can really pretty much do whatever you want and exfiltrate a lot of information. And anyway, there's a link there that you can follow to look at more detail about how that's done. All right, so in summary, security is one of the biggest problems today, typically caused most of the time by very poor design that allows things like buffer overruns. We described a number of solutions, but in particular the use of firewalls, which in practice is the main solution these days. We talked about denial of service attacks, pretty difficult to defeat. A lot of research in this area right now. And finally, we looked at some of the common methods of authentication, two-factor authentication, which potentially is very strong, but you know, it still has the same human weaknesses as all of these methods do. All right, so we'll see you on Wednesday. Otherwise, have a good vacation.